Hey folks, in this video, I'm going to talk about how block handlers work. Keen to find out more? Well, stick around. Let's first of all jump into the documentation here. We're on the left-hand side, we'll expand Create a Project. Let's jump into Mappings. And it's here where you can see that the mapping functions define how chain data is transformed into optimized GraphQL entities. There are three types of handlers. There's a block handler, event, and also a call handler. In this video, we'll talk about what a block handler is. Now, you use a block handler to capture information within a block each time a new block is attached to the substrate chain. You can grab information such as block number and a whole lot more, which we'll look into. To achieve this, you define a block handler, which will be called once for every block. So that's well and fine, but let's jump into the code to really understand how this works. So the first thing I'm going to do is create a standard starter project. Now, the next three commands I'm going to run will be yarn install, yarn code gen, and yarn build. And I'm going to run these really quickly because you really should be familiar with these very easy initial steps. Okay, let's now go and take a look at our mappings file. And you can see here we've got the standard three handlers, the block, the event, and the call. These all map to our manifest file, the handle block, handle event, and handle call as well. Let's go ahead and tidy this up because we really only want to focus on the first one here, the handle block. So I can delete these just to make it simpler. And then down here, I'll go ahead and delete these two as well. I can also delete the various imports up above because I'm not using them anymore. And it's at this point where you can see that I'm grabbing out the block header number, assigning it to the record.fieldNumber1. So this should be very familiar with you. And what I'll do is I'm going to add in a logger because I want to see the output of record.field1. So let's go logger. .info, and I'm going to put in a new line here and say block number, and I'll echo out record.field1. Now, one thing I want to do is I don't want to start from the genesis block or block number one, so I'm going to find out what is the latest block at the moment. So let me go into poker scan. And you can see here that we've got the latest block. So I click on this and I'm going to grab the block height here and I'm going to paste it here. Let me save this. Let me go ahead and rebuild the code before I run the docker compose commands. Now let's run docker compose pull to bring down the images. And we'll spin up the Docker image itself. Okay, so now we've got the container up and running. You can see we're also echoing or logging out the block number. What other information can we grab from the block handler? I'll go ahead and stop this node and let's jump back in. And the first thing we'll do is let's examine the substrate block import. So we'll go to our definition and we'll split this to the right. And you can see that our interface of substrate block, we can also extract spec version and timestamp along with events as well. I'll ignore events for the moment because we'll explore that further in the Substrate event interface. So how do you pull out spec event and timestamp? Well, very easily what we can do is let's add some more information here. Let's go spec version. And then to access this, I need to go block, which is the argument that I'm bringing in. And in fact, let me hit underscore here so you can actually see the difference. I'll go underscore block, I go dot, and if I go SP, I should see spec version available to me. If I go and add another line here, include timestamp as well. Let's save this and compile it or build it and see how this goes. There we go. The blocks are getting fetched and we can see we've got the block number, the spec version, and the timestamp. Now, how do we cross-check this? Well, we can always jump into the Polkadot scanner and we'll compare the latest block on this to the console. You can see here I've got block 740. Let me cancel that. And I'll go across here, 740. And we'll do a quick comparison. Our spec version here is 9090. And it's the same up here as well, 9090. What's our timestamp? UTC, you can see it's 8:24 in the morning. And the timestamp here is also 8:24:24. So all is good. We've managed to extract the block number, the timestamp, and also the spec version. Now, as you can probably imagine, we can also extract the likes of the hash, the parent hash, the state root, extrinsics, etc. So the question is, how do we do this? Well, let's go back into the code and we'll understand what other methods or properties we can extract from the various interfaces. Substrate block extends signed block. So let's go to the signed block definition. Signed block extends signed block with a justification. Let's dig in deeper. Signed block's justification includes something called block and justification as well. So this block here, if you haven't noticed, is the reason for this second block here to access header information. So if I go and dive into the block interface, this extends generic block. And inside generic block here, you can see we've got content hash and we've got header as well. So let's dive into header to see what's available. Inside header, you can see that we've got parent hash, we've got number, which is the actual block number, we've got the state root, extrinsic root, and the digest as well. So let's go ahead and see what these look like. For my parent hash, remember it's block.block.header, because it was hidden in the header, dot parent hash, like so. Let's continue and we'll pull out the state root. So this will be block again, header dot state root. So you should be seeing a pattern here. Then I've got extrinsic root. And this time I'm just going to type in extrinsic root. And why don't we go digest just for good luck. Like so. Let's now go and build this code and we'll run it in Docker again. Okay, there we have it. You can see the node is trying to catch up to the latest block, but we've got the timestamp, the parent hash, the state root, all this information coming out, as well as the digest. So if we go ahead now and do a quick comparison, let's go and jump into subscan, and we'll try and find the latest block here, where you can see we're at 800, we're 801 here, and in the browser we've got 803, just jumped to 5. So I'll go ahead and cancel the node here on 803, and I'll open up 803 in subscan as well. To do a quick comparison, the parent hash is 0xEF795. And up here, we've got EF795, so that's a match. The state root, 697. Let's check out in the console here. The state root here is again 697. So you can see that the information that we're pulling out matches what's in the, effectively, the header of the Substrate blockchain. In the logs, you can see here we've got the digest logs called pre-runtime, and also the seal. So if you want access to the log information here, you can do so using the digest method. So there you have it. If you wanted to do this correctly, what you would do is you would go and modify your schema GraphQL file, and you'd give these proper names with proper types. You would then go ahead and run code gen, and then you could go in your mapping handler, and instead of logging this out to the console, you could log it to values, to variables, in order to use in your front-end application. So hopefully this has given you an insight into how you can grab the various bits of information from the Substrate block header. But please do note that when using a block handler function, your project has to inspect every single block. So you can't take advantage of filters, for example, in your project. Thanks for watching, and catch you on the next video.